Welcome to Emmanuel. The name Emmanuel means God with us. If you're looking for a place where you can explore real faith with real people, if you appreciate big church quality with a small church feel, if you want to partner with others who are committed to bringing real hope to a broken world, then we invite you to experience Emmanuel.
Welcome to Emmanuel. Welcome to fall kickoff at Emmanuel Covenant Church. We are so excited to have you with us here or joining us at the community center today. We are a church that meets here on Tuesday nights for Studio Church at 7:30 at our New Brighton campus. And then at the Shoreview Community Center at 9 and 10:30. We'd love to have you join you for any of those. Today is fall kickoff for our stuff, lots of things. Yeah. But more importantly, it's fall kickoff for the Vikings. Who are the Vikings playing again today, Dan?
They play the New York Giants. I didn't wear my jersey, but I wrote on a whiteboard which got moved, go Giants. So just take it from me, go Giants.
I think the lesson is Dan is about as good of a fan as they are at playing football.
That probably
not
checks
that
out.
Great.
Well, we'll see what happens, but today is a great day because we're kicking off all kinds of great things. Not only is it our kickoff party, but this week is where we start all our fun stuff like kids programming and youth groups and small church and all kinds of stuff. We've got Small Church Connect and MomCo. If you want to get the details of all that, head over to emmanuel.church/fall and you can find all the dates and the information. It's going to be a blast.
And also on that fall page slash fall is the fall retreats. Registration is open right now. You don't want to miss it. If you are a fourth grader through 12th grader, it is a great time. We've got things specifically designed for your age group, and it can be life-changing. Bring your friends. You've heard Chris say that this year, I think we've got three different churches.
We do, yes.
They're participating, which is so cool. So, yes, that's open right now.
Yeah, well, if you need to pause things to go get your communion elements, that would be a great time to do it, because today is communion. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to continue on in our service. So please pray with me. Lord Jesus, thank you for what you're doing today. Thank you for the beginning of this new season. Lord, we know you're always at work, and we're excited to press into a new time where we get to see how you're going to move. So Lord, move in this new season, move in this time, and may you be glorified through everything that happens. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
It is so exciting to start this new season of ministry together, this new season of seeing kids and teens and all of us gathering, experiencing God together in a season where so many things in this world seem kind of unsteady and unpredictable. We serve and celebrate a God who is always good, who is always constant, who is always faithful, who is always worthy of our praise. So let's spend our time right now lifting up that God in a song called Praise. Here we go. One, two, three.
Surrounded.
pray. God, we praise you because you're good, because you're sovereign, because you're true, because you're faithful, all of these reasons. We praise you because if we didn't, the rocks themselves would cry out. God, be honored and be glorified. Spirit, speak to us now in this series, in this time. Help us to be your kingdom people in this world. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Well, happy kickoff Sunday. And if you're wondering why we are starting a series on such a heavy and divisive topic on a season when we're celebrating this brand new ministry season, maybe this will help a little bit. I am so thankful for Mike and for everybody else who contributed to the slide for this teaching series. Mike, can we put that up on the screen? I love this slide. I think this is a great way to frame up this series. I love what it does communicate, and I love what it doesn't communicate. I love that it communicates it's not an easy topic, because the face is all like this, right? I love that. I love also that it's not all stars and stripes and polling places, because as we're going to talk about even today, politics goes way beyond that. It goes way beyond candidates. It goes way beyond different political parties or politicians. I'm also glad that it has a little bit of a lighthearted tone. I'm really glad for that, because I believe it is absolutely possible for us to come out of this series with more hope than many of us came into it with. In fact, I want to say thank you right now to everybody who's really been praying for this series. I believe in you. I believe in this church family. I believe we can navigate this really, really, really well. I'm so thankful that I'm not getting any feedback about, hey, make sure that you do a good beatdown on candidate X or candidate Y. There's enough of that going around all around us. Instead, we see people here at our church that really want to try to say, how can I engage in a more God-honoring way? What does that look like? So that's what we're going to dive into. So I love the graphic. I love the bumper also that Sam created for this with all the different emojis, because at Word Politics, it can bring up all kinds of emotions. So to get us started for this, we're going to do something. We haven't done this for a long, 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 long time. I think we've only done this like once or twice. We're going to pull out our thumb-o-meters. Everyone's got a thumb-o-meter. Here's how it works. If you really agree with something, your thumbs up. If you really disagree with something, your thumbs down, and then it's somewhere in between, all right? So everyone get your thumb-o-meter, and I want those of you who are watching online, I would really love for you to participate with this too. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to put different emojis up on the screen. If when you think of politics, that emoji describes you a lot of the time, it's this. If that emoji describes you none of the time, it's this, and then somewhere in between, all right? Here we go. Let's start with this one. A smiley face. Smiley face emoji. When you think of politics, if that thinks of you, if that describes you most of the time, it's like this. All right. We got medium or thumbs down. Lots of thumbs down here. All right. How about this one? Frowning face. Frowning face. When you think of frowning face, how often is that you? All right. It's almost the opposite of the last one. How about this one? Tears. They're just like, no, tears, all right? How about this one? A pondering face. A pondering face, like, All right? We're getting a lot of that from a lot of people here. All right, how about this one? The rolling of eyes, like, I can't believe this. All right, a lot of that. All right, how about this one? It's rolling eyes plus. It's like rolling eyes, but like looking through your hands, like, oh, cringe. All right, okay? How about this one? This crazy eyes. I'm trying to describe this for the people listening on the podcast. It's just like crazy eyes, concentric circles and face. All right. You feel that way a lot of time? All right. Got just a couple more here. How about angry face? Classic. When politics, how many of you are like, or never, or somewhere between? Okay. How about this one? Angry face that's cussing.
I got a thumbs up that one once in a while. I'll try to watch it. But all right, how about this one? About to vomit face. It makes you sick sometimes, the things that you see. All right, and how about this? You are all out vomiting. It really makes me sick when I think of this. All right, two more. How about this? Laughing face with tears. Like, sometimes it is so ridiculous, I can't even believe it. It brings me to tears laughing. All right, okay. And last one. How many of you are like, oh, dear Lord, save us from all of this. All right, there we go. Thanks to all of you who participated online. This little exercise, I think it's a good way to get started because in real life, those emotions can get really intense, can't they, when it comes to politics. And here's one of the reasons why it can get so intense. If you're taking notes, I invite you to write this down. The way we engage politically has real-world consequences. It's one of the reasons people do get so intense on this. The way we engage politically has real-world consequences. Let's start with how politics are affecting relationships. Let's talk about that for just a minute. One of the books that I read to prepare for this series opened their entire book with this line. Why don't we see grandma and grandpa anymore? Here's the book I got it from. It's a book called The After Party. And this is how they opened up this whole book. And they told the true story of this little family growing up where we were a tight-knit family. The boy gets married and gets married. They have a couple kids and they're going to grandma and grandpa's. But over time, grandma and grandpa in particular is getting more and more political, more and more toxic with his views, to the point where the family thought, we can't even spend time anymore. It is just so ugly every time we do. How tragic is that? How tragic is that? Why don't we see grandma and grandpa anymore? That's what the kids said. Well, if you've got similar stories, this is not just anecdotal. This is a trend. It is a very, very divisive thing. Again, in research for this series, I came across studies that said we are more divided as a nation than we have been since the Civil War. Since the Civil War. Here's another stat. In 1960, only 5% of Americans said they would be displeased if their child married someone from the other political party. By 2010, the number was 40%. Now, that's 14 years ago. Do you think it's gone up or down since then? So from 5% to 40%, we don't even want you to marry one of them. All right, here's another one. January 2017, Reuters poll found that 1 in 6 Americans had stopped talking to a family member or stopped talking to a close friend because of the 2016 election. Broke off relationship with a family member or a friend because of the election. I got this quote, this stat, I should say, from a book, the one I just gave you, from another book. It's called Love Your Enemies by Arthur C. Brooks. This is so good. He is a Christian researcher. He has a PhD in policy analysis, and now he teaches the science of happiness at Harvard University. The science, like he has the science behind happiness. Fascinating guy. That book is so good. He draws a distinction between anger and contempt. That is pure gold. Anger can be really good, really productive. Contempt is destructive. His book is loaded with both scripture and research, which I love. And listen to this. He quotes a study that was conducted back in 2014, so about 10 years ago, by Northwestern University, Boston College, University of Melbourne. It was a study on motive attribution asymmetry. Motive attribution asymmetry is when you assume that my ideology is based on love and their ideology is based on hate. Listen to this. The levels of motive attribution asymmetry that was recorded 10 years ago, in Republicans and Democrats was consistent with what you find with Palestinians and Israelis. Same levels. You guys aren't shocked by this. I was shocked by this. Wow. Well, no wonder that we're seeing what we're seeing. We're seeing everything as us versus them. Instead of I disagree. Let me give you one more statistic before we move on. This one is chilling.
almost 70% of people who used to attend an evangelical church but aren't attending anymore said that their parents' example was a primary factor in them leaving the church and not coming back. Their parents' example. And what was really interesting, it wasn't just they disagreed with the beliefs. You can disagree with beliefs, but here's what they said. It was things like their parents' overemphasis on what they called the culture wars, their parents' inability to listen, their parents' unwillingness to engage with other views, and a lack of love and joy and generosity. We're becoming more and more divided over politics. The statistics are all there. And there's some irony in all of that, how politics is dividing us. Here's why, if you're taking notes, I invite you to write this down. Politics is ultimately about how you do life together. We've turned it into a word that just means like politicians and elections. The word politics, if you trace its origin back to its Greek roots, it's about how do you do life together. That's what it's about. That's what it means. I did as much reading, as much researching, as much listening as my schedule would allow for the last several months leading up to this series. And in my studies, I frequently came across quotes like this: keeping politics out of Christianity is impossible because Christianity is inherently political. Again, not meaning elections and politicians, meaning it's about how we do life together. All right? I had never looked at the Bible through that lens before. Never. Partly because I didn't have that definition of politics. Once you do, once you say Christianity is about how we do life together, you can't unsee it. It is everywhere in the Bible. Our origin story in Genesis, what's it about? It's about how you do life under God's sovereign rule. The central, or I should say central to God's calling of Abraham, was how he and his descendants were to serve as a light and example to the world around them. The books of Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, they focus on how do you do life together as God's people? And then how do you interact with the rest of these nations around you? That's what it's about. I'm rereading Matthew right now. Look at how Jesus begins his ministry. He comes out of this temptation into what we call the Sermon on the Mount. Reread the Sermon on the Mount. Wow. What a vision is being casted for a new kind of community. In the book of Acts, we see examples of the movement that Jesus founded, and they're navigating all these different spaces, sometimes where they're welcomed, sometimes where they're just tolerated, sometimes where they're confronted, sometimes where they're rejected, sometimes where what they're trying to do is outlawed. You see them trying to navigate all of this. In Paul's letters, we have all kinds of instructions about representing Jesus and his way in cities like Rome and Corinth and Philippi. And then the book of Revelation, it describes the end of the age. What happens in the end of the age? King Jesus comes back, and he sets all as it should be. The book I read that did the best job of reminding us that the books of the Bible are each birthed in a unique political context is this one, Jesus and the Powers. If you want the history, this is a great resource. Jesus and the Powers, N.T. Wright. Does an exceptional job of reminding us every book of the Bible has a political context to it. And the Bible is applicable in all of these situations that we face. Here's a sample quote from that book. If the gospel announces that Jesus is king, then we must wrestle with what his kingship means in Tiananmen Square, on the foot of the floor of the U.S. Congress, in the lunchroom of Walmart, or in the choices that we make at the ballot box. There will be a day when politics are no more. Before then, what do we need? We need wisdom. Can I get an amen to that? We need wisdom. How do we do this well? That's what we're going to attempt to do in the weeks ahead. We're going to attempt to engage this important topic of how we do life together. We're going to try to do it well. If you're taking notes, I invite you to write these next two things down. How do we avoid, as we're doing this well, engaging poorly? How do we avoid engaging poorly? And secondly, how do we avoid disengaging poorly? Because you can do that too, right? You can engage poorly and you can also disengage poorly. It can be really, really, really tempting to disengage, can it? To just go, this thing is so broken. This thing is so dysfunctional. I'm out. I'm not going to waste any time with this. Have you heard there's an older cartoon called Calvin and Hobbes? Have you seen the Calvin and Hobbes? All right. Here's a cartoon that speaks to that. We're going to try to throw a little Calvin and Hobbes over the next couple of weeks. In panel one, Calvin says, you know, the more that you know, the harder it is to take divisive action. Panel two says, once you become informed, you start seeing complexities and shades of gray. Panel three, Calvin says, you realize nothing is as clear and simple as it first appears. Ultimately, knowledge is paralyzing. And then in the final panel, he tosses the book he was reading over his shoulder and he says, being a man of action, I can't afford to take that risk. To which his friend replies, you're ignorant, but at least you act on it. It can be really, really, really tempting to disengage, can it? You start digging and you're going, this is a mess. This is complicated. This is really, really hard. This is dysfunctional. So you want to disengage completely. Here's why that's off the table for us. To disengage completely. If you're taking notes, I encourage you to write this down. There's too much at stake to sit on the sidelines. And this is not me blowing a whistle for either candidate. This is me saying there's too much at stake to sit on the sidelines. Let me give you a clear example of this. Should the Church of Jesus Christ have sat on the sidelines during the civil rights activity of the 50s and 60s? Should we have just sat on the sidelines? Of course not. Martin Luther King Jr. put it like this. He said, it might be true that a law can't make a man love me, but it can refrain him from lynching me. And I think that's pretty important also. So while the law may not change the hearts of men, it does change the habits of men. In the Bible, Jesus called religious people out. Called them out for focusing on little things while neglecting what Jesus himself called the weightier matters of the law. That's Jesus. And what did he say were some of the examples of weightier matters? It was justice, it was mercy, it was faithfulness. I mean, consider just some of the weighty matters that we can influence. Think of it in our work together. Where does freedom of speech begin and end? That's a weighty matter. And that's one of the things that politics wrestles with. Where does religious freedom begin and end? And then who enforces that? How about this? What steps do we take to protect our citizens and their property? That's a political matter. What steps do we take to protect those who are most vulnerable? How are these protections enforced? How are people held accountable if they break and violate these things? Here's another category. What steps do we take to protect our citizens from other nations? That's a political matter. What do we do? How do we declare war? When? How and when do we assist other nations in their areas of need? Here's another category. How much do we collect in taxes? And where does it go? What rights do people have over their personal property? How much direct say should citizens have in any of these matters? That's political talk. How about this one? What parental rights do we recognize? Under what circumstances can the desires of a parent be ignored? That's a political question. When does human life begin? And who makes that decision? How do we educate the next generation? Who makes decisions on the content that we teach? Who pays for what? What legacy, speaking of the next generation, that is a big thing on the hearts of our church. What legacy do we leave? It's a political matter. How much debt is okay for us to accumulate and pass on to the next generation? How much pollution is okay for us to pass on to the next generation? How many non-renewable resources do we just consume in our generation? How much investment should we be making into the future? These are all questions of how do we do life together? The list is endless. This was one of those weeks I'm hitting print. I'm supposed to be here usually I'm supposed to be here by 5:30, but I'm hitting print at 6:30. Because there's so many questions. Like, how do you even stop this list? This is it. Healthcare, racial justice, caring for the poor and marginalized, governmental transparency and accountability. What services should be private? What should be public? How do we respond to a natural disaster? Should we protect natural habitats? Things that we consider national treasures. When politics goes south, whether it's people that have bad ideas, whether it's people promise one thing and do something else, or whether it's people, I'm sincere, but I don't know how to do it, not qualified. When politics goes south, it affects real people. It affects real people. That's why we can't just sit on the sidelines. But then how do we do it well, right? Consider this quote, N.T. Wright and Michael Bird from that book I referenced earlier. Perhaps the single greatest threat is not the rise of secularism or the emptying of churches, but the apathy and indifference of the churches that are still here. Ouch. Ouch. We have important perspectives to add to this conversation. So how do we do that well? Well, we begin where we try to begin everything else, with the scriptures. With the scriptures. A really helpful book that my assistant Mindy connected me to about this topic is this one. It's called The Ballot and the Bible. This book is really interesting because what she does is she goes back in history, especially the history of America, and she's like, let's show some examples of how the Bible was used, but it was not used well. Really, really helpful resource. Really helpful resource because people do that all the time. You'll hear the Bible quoted, but it's often taken out of context, all that kind of stuff. The author, Caitlin Scheiss, she reminds us of this. The Bible is a gift of God, from God to the church, given for a particular purpose to shape that community, become more authentic in our worship, to become better at living this out, to be better examples, all these things. All right, let's take a look at one of the countless passages the Bible offers and gives guidance to in this area. If you have your Bible with you, let's open up to Philippians chapter 1, verses 27 through 28. If you don't have a Bible at home, we want to encourage you right now, hit pause. There is a great free Bible app out there at Bible.com. It's an outstanding resource. All right, here we go. Philippians 1, we're going to look at verses 27 through 28. First, a little context. Paul's letter to the Philippians, this is another example of God speaking into, through Paul, God speaking into a very complex situation. Philippi was a Roman colony. It was founded by Roman war veterans. It was known for its patriotic nationalism. Paul also knew their situation well. Why did he know it well? Because he spent time there. A lot of the time that he spent there was where? It was in jail, in prison. He ends up just trying to help this slave girl, ends up getting beaten with the permission of the magistrate with rods, and then thrown in prison. And now he's writing from a different prison to the Christians in Philippi, where he was imprisoned. This letter, it is a masterclass in so many things. One of the things that he does is right in the middle of it in chapter 2, there is this incredible poetic description of Jesus that really emphasizes Jesus' humility and his service and his sacrifice. And then all the rest of these narratives, all the rest of these pieces that he puts in there are really about how can our lives reflect more of that, more of the example that Jesus set. So with that context, here we go, verses 27 through 28. Only let your manner of life, and what I want to like to right now, take a quick glance at the screens there, because that manner of life is a special Greek word, so just keep that in the mind. And what word does that look like to you, perhaps? Look a little bit like politics? That's one of the words we get politics from. So let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come to and see you or I'm absent, I may hear of you that you're standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel, and not frightened in anything by your opponents. This is a clear sign to them of their destruction, but of your salvation and that from God. All right, there's wordplay here, because you saw that word that looks like politics. Let's jump ahead now to chapter 3, verses 17 through 20. And look, there's another word there, another Greek word, where you see coming up that also looks a lot like politics. Here we go. Chapter 3, verses 17 through 20. Brothers, sisters, join in imitating me and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example that you have in us. For many of whom I've often told you and now tell you even with tears, walk as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their end is destruction. Their God is their belly. Their glory is their shame, with minds that are set on earthly things. But our citizenship, and there's another Greek word, looks a lot like politics. Our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul uses words that we get our English word politics from, to drive home the point that we're citizens of the kingdom of what? The kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of? You can say it out loud. Kingdom of heaven. Thank you. The kingdom of heaven. What does Jesus say about the kingdom of heaven when he appears on the scene? Here's what he says in Matthew. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is what? It's here. Kingdom of heaven is here. It's here and it's coming. It's both of those things. That's one of the reasons it's complex, right? How do we live as citizens of heaven here as we also await a version of it that is yet to come? Well, the Bible says we're ambassadors. Ambassadors. What do ambassadors do? They represent one kingdom in another kingdom. My brothers and sisters, I invite you to write these things down. They're going to come rapid fire. You and I, we are uniquely equipped to model a better way as ambassadors. Uniquely equipped. I wish we had another 4 or 5 hours right on this section. I'm just going to blow through with you. We are uniquely equipped to model a better way. The Bible, you talk about party platforms, the Bible provides an unparalleled platform. Unparalleled platform. The things that our souls long for. Jesus was an exceptional party crasher. What do I mean by that? He didn't fit in any of the parties of his day. The Holy Spirit, the same Holy Spirit that was present in the book of Acts, inspires, empowers, and sanctifies today. We're also family. We're family. We got this multinational group of people that have been adopted into the kingdom of God, and we've been saved by grace. Why does that matter so much? We're really going to press into that in weeks 4 and 5. As followers of Jesus, because we recognize we've been saved by grace, we are uniquely positioned to go, yeah, there really is evil in this world. And we know the source of it. And it's not that person. It's a deeper source of evil. And we recognize we all make mistakes. We're all short-sighted. We all have blind spots. So if I've got them, you've got them. Let's work together and see what we can learn from one another. I want to say also this here at the onset of the series. I am thankful for the guardrails that are in place for a church to have this conversation. I'm actually thankful for those. As a 501c3 nonprofit, there's certain things, certain lines we're not supposed to cross. And I'm glad those guardrails are in place because that could really be manipulated. If you could just funnel money in and be an advocate for one candidate or one party or something like that, that, man, that opens up a whole host of really bad things. If you want to go ahead and found a for-profit religious organization that is all about one candidate or one party, you can do that. But I really like these guardrails because what it helps us do is say, we can't be bought. We're not just all in on one person. We're not all in on one party. Instead, we're all in on Jesus. And we're going to try to navigate what that looks like. What does Jesus have to say to this candidate or this party? I really appreciate that. In the weeks ahead, so we're not going to tell you who to vote for. What we are going to do, though, we're going to cast a vision. We're going to cast a vision of what could happen if we don't just pledge our allegiance or we don't just outsource the hard work of helping people flourish to a single party or a single candidate. So here's our roadmap for the weeks ahead. We did the best we could to really listen to people to try to say, where are the blind spots? Where are the pain points? And here's what we're going to do for the next 6 weeks. The next 2 weeks, you are going to be blessed because we've got Dr. Joel Lawrence, who's going to be leading these conversations. I'm seeing some people nod. This is a national treasure who's right here at our church. He's going to lead us into Genesis chapters 1 through 4 and then also in the book of Revelation. He's going to help us take a deeper dive into where did we start, what happened, how did we get here, and where do we land? This is such a paradigm setter. It is so good. If you don't know Joel, I'm so excited to introduce him to you over the next couple of weeks. He is the president of the Center for Pastor Theologians, which means he's the president of this organization that equips pastors nationally and internationally to help them become better at being theologians who can apply this in the real world. So that's weeks 2 and 3. In week 4, we're calling this one Pledge Allegiance, Pledging Allegiance. We live in a culture that hasn't been this us versus them since the Civil War. So how do we navigate the war zone How do we navigate where so many people are like, you're either with me or I hate you? How do we do that? How do we navigate that world we're in? We're going to look at different models. This was so fun and found multiple different models that Christians are trying to use. We're going to look at several of these different ones. You're going to see yourself in some of these. We're going to talk about what's the good, the bad, and the ugly in these different models. It's really going to be helpful. All right. We're calling week 5 of our 7-part series, Serpents and Doves. Where does that come from? It comes from something Jesus said, right? That we're to be as wise as serpents, as innocent as doves. And he said that specifically. We're going to dig into the context. He said that specifically as he was sending out his disciples. You are going out like sheep among wolves, he said. As you do, be as wise as a serpent, as innocent as doves. Why do I feel so passionate about that's one of our 7? I see so many people believing so many lies. I see so many people just swallowing stuff they're being told instead of really looking into it. I see so many people falling into traps that have been designed to catch you and make you filled with contempt. So we're going to press into that. How can we be as wise as a serpent and also as innocent as a dove? All right. A lot of you are going to appreciate week 6. Here's what we're going to do week 6. We're calling week 6 Stewarding Your Vote. The original title for this series was going to be, how do you vote when you don't know how? When you feel like, how do I do this? Okay, if you've been distracted by something, tune in for this, because I think this is one of the most important things I'm going to say all morning long here, or all day long, today. We're ambassadors with voting rights. How did I like not put those things together ever before? We're ambassadors with voting rights. Where does that happen? Think of that opportunity we have. We model, we live out, we don't wait for the world to do stuff, we do stuff, and we also have voting rights. Okay, how do we steward that really, really well? That's what we're gonna press into in week 6, especially when you have a candidate that you're not excited about. How do you then steward that vote well? And then, week 7, our final week of the series, we're calling it Beyond the Ballot Box. Voting is just one of so many ways we can make an impact. Just one of many. So we're going to say, yeah, vote, steward well, but don't put all of your everything into voting. There are so many ways we can make a difference in our world. And then along the way, we are going to introduce you to all kinds of great resources. We're creating a resource page, emmanuel.church/resources. We will have books there. We'll have videos there. We'll have examples of organizations that you can look at that are trying really hard. There are a whole lot of people trying really, really hard to make a difference here. It's been so good. Digging into this, I am coming away so challenged. I'm coming away very convicted, especially on that contempt thing. I'm like, man, I was totally in that trap. I'm also coming out of this really hopeful. There are so many people who are creating such helpful resources and doing such good work right now. It's not just, hey, no one's doing anything. A lot of people are doing a lot of things. So I'm excited about that. In fact, see David back there. David's going to be helping us with a really practical thing. We're going to create a video. David's going to be in this video of like, the practical stuff. How do you get involved locally? A lot of us were like, okay, I vote every 4 years, you know, but like the whole process, just how can you make a difference and how can you get involved and what is that like? So all kinds of resources are going to be there. The purpose of all of this is to help us join a different kind of party. And if you're taking notes, here's the last thing that we're inviting you to write down. We invite you to join a very different kind of party. In the midst of all the ugliness and dysfunction, I confess I've lost track of the incredible opportunity and responsibility we have. We are ambassadors who also get a vote. We can speak into ways to help people flourish. We can protect religious freedoms. We can speak into building stronger families. We can speak into allowing people to pursue their dreams. We can speak into protecting the innocent and holding the guilty accountable. We can equip the poor and marginalized with resources they need to thrive. We can speak into all of these things while modeling a humble, curious, and collaborative posture and while not waiting to say, well, the only way that gets done is politically. We can do stuff. Right here, right now, We invite you to join a multi-generational, multicultural, multinational, multi-century movement of people who believe in the vision that Jesus of Nazareth cast for a new kind of community. And it's in that spirit that we're going to share an idea that comes from another book I read. This one's called The Party Crasher. That's where I got that, that language. Party Crasher. It's by Joshua Butler. Inside, if you're here, inside your bulletins, there's a sheet that says a Christian community commitment. You can pull that out. We're going to put on the screens here. What we're going to be asking you to do or to consider over the course of the series is to take this that somebody else created, which I love. I love that there's other people out there doing these things. Take this, and some of you are here for a Pathway series, we call it Pathways, where you can be transformed with renewing of your mind. Imagine if, over the course of these next 7 weeks, imagine if every day you started your day reading this. It says things like this. Worship. I commit my allegiance to King Jesus over all idols and ideologies. Love of neighbor. I commit to participating in civic life as a mean of loving and serving my neighbor rather than just serving my own interests. Image of God. I commit to honoring the image of God in all people, treating them with respect, and abstaining from dehumanizing caricatures. Biblical wisdom. I commit to having my views challenged by the Bible, biblical story, rather than using the Bible to proof text my predetermined positions. Biblical justice. I commit to understanding and pursuing justice as I engage in civic life, not minimizing the scripture's repeated call to seek justice and allowing scripture to critique popular conceptions of justice in our culture. Fruitful speech. I commit to engaging in political discourse with speech that is marked by the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Peacemaking. I commit to face-to-face conflict resolution rather than vitriolic arguments on social media or talking behind someone's back. Does the world need more of that? Yeah. All right, removing the log. I commit to giving more attention to examining the potential flaws in my own political leanings, conduct, and sin than I give to scrutinizing others. Humble learning. I commit to being quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger as I seek to learn from the varied perspectives within the body of Christ. Loving enemies. I commit to loving and praying for my so-called political enemies, especially those that I have the hardest time loving and praying for. This includes a commitment to praying for our government leaders, regardless of who wins the election. Do you think our world would be a better place or a worse place if more of us would recite that every morning and every night during the season? I think better. We can become transformed through renewing of our minds. And we have an incredible opportunity before us. In a recent study, 93% of Americans said they're tired of how divided we've become. 93%. And then they go back to their feeds that feed all of the toxic stuff, right? Let's live differently. Let's follow authentically the way of Jesus. Let's try to even set out to see if we can discover what that even means. Let's do it. There's a better way, a different way, the way of Jesus. And what better way to commit to the way of Jesus than to come together around the Lord's table? When we do that here at Emmanuel, we commemorate a real event. It says this about that event in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat of the bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." There's so much that the Bible doesn't say about this sacrament of Holy Communion. It doesn't give a specific age. It doesn't give a specific method. It doesn't say that we're supposed to use a specific kind of bread or wine. But here's what the Bible does say. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 28. Let a person examine themselves. So we're going to pray a prayer here together. And if you can sincerely pray this prayer with us, we invite you to participate in this event right where you are. Have a piece of bread, have some juice or wine. And we pray these prayers, if you can sincerely pray them with us, we invite you to receive the body and blood of Christ wherever you are. right here at the studio, for those who are new, we don't have any ushers here during this time. If this is something you'd like to participate in and that you can sincerely pray these prayers, we would welcome you to come. There'll be a station right up here anytime during these songs for you to come up. What we would say, though, is reflect. Make this real. Invite the Holy Spirit to examine ourselves and say, how can I come away from this place laying down the things that aren't of you and following the way of Jesus? So let's do that right now. Let's join together in these prayers. Heavenly Father, to whom all hearts and minds are open and all desires are known, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may more perfectly love you and more worthily magnify your holy name. We confess that we are sinners and cannot save ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. We are not worthy for these gifts which we are about to receive, but say the word, and we will be made clean. Lord, we want to dedicate ourselves, we want to dedicate our church, we want to dedicate all of this to you. May we really hear from you during this series. May we really be changed as a result of your Holy Spirit's work within us. And now as one more act of unity before we engage in this just beautiful, beautiful time, we pray this prayer that you taught your disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
As we enter into this time of communion together, we want to start by introducing a song that's probably new to many of you. It's a song that's called The Jesus Way that we just discovered recently. It's a relatively new song by Phil Wickham. We'll put it on our resources page. But it kind of says, it points to the juxtaposition, kind of like the Sermon on the Mount, you may have heard, but I tell you. And this song just goes through, when if you hurt me, I'm going to bless you. If you hate me, I'm going to love you. It's this juxtaposition, and it's not meant to be Pollyanna, but it does point to just how radical Jesus' approach is, how different his party is and the systems and the politics of this world. It's easy, so sing along if you'd like as you get to know it. And we'll be doing it a number of times throughout this series. It's called The Jesus Way. If you curse me, then I will bless you. If you hurt me, I will forgive. If you hate me, then I will love you. I choose the Jesus way. If you're helpless, I will defend you. If you're burning, I'll share the weight. And if you're hopeless, then let me show you there's hope in the Jesus way. Jesus way.
Sun is fine.
hey, thank you so much for joining us. We hope you can come back next week because Dr. Joel Lawrence is going to be here. I have never heard anyone do a better job of connecting the dots between Genesis 1 and 2, Genesis 3 and 4, and all these challenges that we've faced ever since. So hope you can join us next week. Between now and then, go with this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
I have
We're this not up. Gonna take it. No.
No.
We're not gonna take it.
No.
We're not gonna.